Hey folks, I'm going to do an update on my super diorama. So the last 4 or 5 days, maybe a little longer, maybe closer to a week, I guess, I've been working on building the train station here. It's done now. It's pretty much just all built up and ready for paint. The only thing that I have left to do to it is build a little bit of furniture and stick in there, like benches for people to sit on while they're waiting, and cabinetry for like the station master to keep his shit in, and a roll-up desk for him to do paperwork at and stuff. Everything else is done in there. I'm trying to decide if I want to scratch build some crates and stuff to put in the top floor, or if I want to buy some crates, just like a kit of just wooden crates, and stick them in there. They will go on the top floor up here. But essentially everything else is finished. The bulk of it I can just paint it now if I want to. But before I get to that, I'm actually going to sit down at the bench, which is right there, with the train station and talk about that, and talk about doing brickwork and stuff like that in a minute. But I want to talk a bit more about the diorama itself. Before I get too far ahead of myself, I've been asked why I haven't painted anything yet. It's because if I paint anything while I'm still in the process of trying to make sure everything is all gonna fit. See, it's almost impossible to develop a layout on paper without exact measurements, and until you build a kit, you don't really have exact measurements. I mean, you know, kits come with some dimensions and stuff like that sometimes, like Revell gives you usually dimensions of the built kit and everything like that. Not all of them do that, so it's really difficult to get a full scope of how things are going to fit until you actually build the kit and go, okay, that'll fit there, that'll fit there. So if I build everything that I want to put on and then lay it all out, then I know for sure, no, that's not going to fit, that's not going to fit, this is just too busy, this is not going to work. So that's basically what I'm working on. Now, if I paint them and then start to do that, they're just going to get all beat to shit. I'm like, you know, I'll knock bits off and stuff as I'm moving them around, trying to figure out where this is going to go, where that's going to go. And then when I knock bits off, it means I have to fix it. It's just easier to fix when it's just bare plastic. Or if I lose a part, it's easier to just scratch build it and replace it, you know, rather than having to scratch build, replace it, and then repaint the whole thing. So that's why nothing's painted. And it's going to remain that way until the diorama itself is completed and ready for paint, and then I'm going to start painting the vehicles. So that's what's going on, why nothing's painted. I would love to be able to paint them, but because I just recently cleared out my paint bench, which is over there. It was all, most of the foam that you see here was actually sitting over there. Hi, how are you? I was actually waving at myself on the monitors over there, and the camera's right here. So that's why it didn't look like, now I'm looking at the camera. Hi, how are you there? That wasn't weird. Anyway, so that's why nothing's painted, and that's why, that's the madness behind the idea. So I buy all the shit that I want to put on, I build it, and then see if it'll fit. To see if it'll tell the story that I want to tell. I'm running into issues right now. Because I reduced the width of the diorama, I'm now discovering that there's probably going to be maybe a bit of either rearranging or elimination of some elements that they're just not going to work. Which saddens me a bit, because it means I have to make changes, and I don't like making changes, but I don't want it to be just too full. That wouldn't be inaccurate. A train yard around a train station is a very busy place, so having a lot of shit around there is not exactly inaccurate, but it makes it annoying to look at. And, you know, you have to use a little bit of artistic, not artistic license, but artistic awareness in order to be able to tell your story, in order for the story to be understood when you're trying to represent a historical situation. It's part of how the thing's going to work, right? You know, I'm not a big fan of artistic license when it comes to modeling. I do use it now and again, but I'm not. It's easy to go overboard and then use it as an excuse. That's when I start having an issue with it. When you start using artistic license as an excuse to get away with shit or to cover up your mistakes, I don't like that very much, right? But as a lot of people know, I don't like a lot of shit. I'm a cranky old fuck. I had a rant on my Facebook page there a couple of days ago about YouTube shorts, and apparently I'm not the only one that hates those fucking things. I fucking hate YouTube shorts. Like, oh fuck. I have gone to great lengths to try and find ways to block them completely from my feed, my subscriptions feed. I managed to successfully do it on my computer. On my computer, I never see any ads on YouTube, and I never see any of those fucking annoying shorts. If I want to watch short, inane, pointless videos with no content, that's what TikTok and Instagram is for. I end up watching cat videos or dog videos. I don't understand how you can do shorts with YouTube for modeling. I've watched a couple. They're a waste of my time. So I've actually unsubscribed a couple of channels because that's all they've been doing lately is nothing but shorts. And I have no time at all to be wasted on watching pointless, inane videos. So, I fucking hate YouTube shorts, and I'm happy to know I am not the minority. Not this time, anyway. The vast majority of people I talk to hate them. So YouTube is trying to make us believe that they're awesome, but apparently we're not swallowing that tripe this time. So I'm hoping that they're going to be a fucking short-lived trend and die out, and I can go back to my regular scheduled program. Anyway, rant over. If you're making YouTube short, stop it, because I want to subscribe to your channel again. Because it's irritating. The reason why I unsubscribed is not because of the computer thing. It's because on my iPad, I haven't been able to find a way to block them yet. Nobody's come up with an app or an extension for any of the browsers that blocks YouTube Shorts yet. So it's just fucking annoying having to hide them all the time. It's just irritating, right? So I don't use the app on my iPad. I hate the app. YouTube app sucks. Anyway. Blah, 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 blah. That has nothing to do with what we're talking about. So, anyway. I finished the train station. I just started working on this. If you're wondering what the hell that is a water tower. Basically, what happens is a steam locomotive pulls up and stops right next to it. And there's like a big pipe that sticks out and overhangs the train. And it pours water into the steam engine because in order to make steam, you need water, and this is where it comes from, right? They have these really cool ones that are like this all over Europe. They had them back during the Second World War in the 30s and the 20s and stuff. They're really weird-looking things. They look like aliens. Over here in North America, they were different. They were like, it's like a big wooden platform, like a trellis that was built with a big barrel, huge barrel that was on top of it, and had like a boom that would come down and, you know, put the water in the train. Essentially the same idea. These things are fancier though. They had this like a pedestal and then a big, like it was a much smaller system. Maybe because the trains are smaller, they didn't go as far, or they didn't use as much water. I don't really know. But either way, they weren't as big. At least they don't look as big. So the train would pull up, and same thing would happen. This boat would come down, and it had a rubber bladder hose, and it would, pour water inside the train. The train would go. So, but that's what that is. So I'm attempting to scratch build one. And so far, it's been interesting. It's not going to be exactly like, because most of them are like a perfect cylinder. on top of a pedestal, and the pedestals, most of them are round. There's a couple that are fluted, but most of them are round pedestals. And almost all of the actual barrels are perfect cylinders. Mine is slightly conical because it's a yogurt container. And I didn't have anything anywhere. I looked all over the place trying to find something that was the right size that wasn't conical. Every cylinder that I had had a fucking taper in it. So I just said, fuck it. I stopped looking and I used that. That's what I'm going to use. So anyway. So that's what we're using. I finished all the beams. These are all the railroad ties that are spread out underneath where the carl is deployed, and the carl sits on them, and basically when it drops down and then turns and then moves away, it doesn't tear up the track when it does. This thing weighs 120 some odd tons, and it'll just tear all the track all to bits when it turns. So they put all these railroad ties, or they would infill it with gravel and fill and stuff to protect the tracks, so they don't have to relay all the tracks. I'm pretty sure they didn't always do this, because this is quite laborious and that's a lot of material, but I saw two photos where in the distance back behind the carl on the track was a flatbed covered in rail ties. And so I'm assuming, from anecdotal information and from talking to a couple of people and looking at a couple of photos and putting two and five together and coming up with a zebra with wings, that's what the railroad ties are for, is for leveling the surface so that they don't have to rebuild the tracks. They would do a catastrophic amount of damage to railroad tracks when it dropped and turned and moved off. So they would have to have some kind of support around there in order to keep it from doing that. That thing would really fuck up your day if you were laying tracks. The other thing I did was I finished this thing here. This is the portal. That's all got the stonework done and everything. That's all ready for paint now. One thing I am going to do is right here, this piece of hillside in the back is going to get built up just slightly right here, so it meets up a little bit, so it doesn't have this L shape here. You see right there, there's like an L shape. I want more of a slope in there. So I've got to put a little bit more foam in there, glue it on, and then shave it off. Actually, I'm showing you a video right now of me actually making that. It's super sped up because it's really long and boring, and I don't say a word while I'm doing it. I carved this, that, and that little bit there, and got it all hillside shaped. So that's basically what was going on with that. I am going to show you a little clip of me carving the stone. Actually, I'm not sure yet. I might actually demonstrate it myself, carving the stone that's in that the bridge portal. And I'll show you how I did the brickwork in the train station as well, because it's two different types. So I might do that here in a second. And just so you guys can see the easy way to do it. I've demonstrated those before, but, ad nauseum. One more thing. So right now, it looks like it's really busy on this side and not so busy on that side. And there's a reason for that. It's because there's no figures. There's only a couple of figures here and there. Most of them right now are on this side, but this entire hillside is going to be covered with resting troops because they're sitting there hanging out waiting for a train to come pick them up, or for trucks to come pick them up and take them to the front, or take them back home, or I don't know, make sandwiches with them. I don't know, but either way, what they're doing is they're hanging out on that hillside, so this hillside will be somewhat populated by bored Germans. The color palette and topography of the scene is going to be like a khaki tan color with some rusty umber colors mixed in there. It's basically the same color scheme that you would see in Turkey or Greece or some parts of Italy. It's the same tone scheme in there. But intermixed with greens and like light browns and dark browns and stuff of the vegetation that are in there, and the varying degrees of grasses as well. It's not going to be a lot of grass. There'll be some, but not much. And it'll be probably varying back and forth between fresh grass and dead grass. But the vast majority of the vegetation is going to be scrub and bush. I'm going to try to scratch build an arbutus tree and have it on this hill here. Arbutus is kind of a cool tree. You can look it up. Or I can just show you the picture like I'm showing you now. The weird tree. We have them here in Canada. They're on the west coast in BC. They're a really fucked up looking tree. Especially when you see them with all the other normal looking trees that you see, or you would expect to see for Canadian forests, like pine trees, maple trees, birch trees, and what you in the UK call larch. We call them tamarack here. And you know, you see them, and all of a sudden you see this weird fucked up looking tree with red bark, right? Well, they have those in Crimea, which is cool, and I want to try and scratch build one and have it there, and we'll see how well that goes. So that's what's going there. In this area here, it's the whole surface right now is dead flat because I haven't sculpted anything in. Don't do that. I haven't sculpted anything, any of the surface in here, but it's all going to have, it's not going to be like, you know, rolling hills or anything like that. It's just going to be uneven because it's ground, natural ground. And but you know, the area around the train track will be manicured because it's man-made, and covered in ballast, which is gravel. But the area between the tracks, there'll be some grassy area in around there, and a little bit with some vegetation along the edges on the front here, and again on this hillside, and over here as well. So that's pretty much it for that. So that's my thoughts on the diorama. That's where we're going, and yeah, I think that's what we're doing. Right, I'm going to take the train station, and I'm going to move it over there, and talk about that for a minute or two, and then demonstrate the brickwork. Right, so this is the train station, and it's a bit more elaborate than my normal buildings, and I mean the reason for that is well, it was mostly because I tried to do it completely out of foam. Normally when I build buildings, they're a combination of wood, popsicle sticks and coffee stirrers for structure, and maybe some like hardboard foam, that stuff that's like it's foam core with paper backing. And like it's like laminated with paper, and then over that I'll add texture using foam or putties or like drywall compound or whatever. That's normally, and there's a lot of different materials that come together to make a sort of okay maybe slab building depending on how it works. And I've never really done a full interior of a building before, not like this. So I wanted to make this light because this diorama weighs a ton. I didn't want to add to the weight by having a big heavy building on it. The same thing is going to go for the embankment is also quite light. It's just a chunk piece of foam. It's not going to be covered in like rocks and stuff. Like it's all going to be done in lightweight materials, plaster and pieces of foam in order to make the rocks. So the same idea behind this, I wanted to make it light. It's done almost completely out of foam with just a little bit of wood for doing things that I didn't think looked good in foam. When I first started building this, the base for it, the platform here, just the foundation just for the building, not these two pieces here, but just underneath here. When I first started building, it was too narrow. And I didn't really notice it until I started putting on these beams on the outside. And I know they're not in the right place. So any of you architectural folks and stuff like that, you're looking at this one here going, oh, no. Yeah, I know that. I know that's not in the right place. It's because I put the windows in a weird spot, and then I decided I wanted to add these after, because the original photo of the train station that I used as inspiration had them. So I thought, oh, let's throw those on there too. So I know that's not supposed to be there. But it's there anyway, because I like it. So there you go. And I haven't added brick texture to these yet, but I will. So the foundation was too narrow, so I had to scrap it and make an entirely new one, but I didn't want to throw away the old one. So what I did is I cut it completely in half and turned it into the platform. Waste not, want not, because it already had like brick texture carved into it, and it had wood decking carved into it. And I said, fuck, why would I waste that? I just use that. So I did. So I just split it in half and glued it to the outside. Now it's the platform for when people are waiting for trains and stuff like that. So this back one here is for cargo. So when, you know, cargo needs to be delivered and stuff like that, that's why it has the big concrete ramps on either side. On this side here, there's a good chance that probably this window here is going to be turned into a door. So it'll be cut down and the bottom part here will be reformed. Because I have a mini art set of stairs, an industrial external stairs that is going to go right here. So that's how things get into the upper floor. I didn't want to put stairs inside the building. The reason why is because it would take up an enormous amount of real estate inside the building, and I wanted to use the inside of the building for inside of the building stuff. And I'll explain that in a moment. It's not uncommon for industrial buildings to have the stairs on the outside for the same purpose, to increase the amount of square footage on the floor for storage. So that's what happened here. So this is going to be turned into a door, most likely, and stairs are going to be attached to the outside once the set of stairs arrive, which hopefully won't be too long. The windows haven't been glazed yet, but that'll happen probably closer to the time I'm going to paint this. There's a good chance that I'm going to replace this roof. I'm not completely happy with the way it's lined up. It could be just a smidge longer on either side and a bit neater looking. It's a bit sloppy and I want to change it. There is a chance I just may not, but you know, I may still do that. It's not a great deal to do that. I don't even have to redo the chimney. The chimney, I can just pop that out and keep it and then build a new roof. And doing the shingles would be a pain in the ass, but they're not as difficult as you think. Shingles were done actually quite simply. I basically take a piece of foam like this, but a longer one, right? Actually, it's the length of this, right? And if you notice, this is quite thick. I actually would cut this on my foam cutter. I have a tabletop foam cutter right here behind me, a Proxon one. I would basically cut this into a very thin sheet, like these. Actually this is what I used right here. So I take this and then I take my razor saw, right, and then I add wood grain to it by dragging the teeth across it. Don't want it to be too regular, so I'm adding wood grain texture to this. So now there's wood grain texture on this, and then I take it over to the Proxon and slice it this way into long strips, and then I glue the strip on one at a time, and I layer them so that they're, you know, one sitting on top of, like, for example, if these were these things very, very tiny. They'd be sitting on top of each other like this, all right? And then so on, all the way up to the top. And then once the glue's dried, I come back with a tool like this with a sharp edge on it, and I carve in the individual shingles, which is, that's the time-consuming, laborious part. It is much faster to do it that way than it is to cut the individual tiles and glue them on one at a time. I've done that, and it's 2 to 3 weeks worth of tedious work. What's really funny is I'm currently watching the exact same TV show that I was watching the last time I shingled a roof. It's really weird how that worked out. It's Star Trek Enterprise, and it's Rodney in Newfoundland. It's his fuss. Rod, it's his fault. He was building Star Trek. He was building an Enterprise, and it got me inspired to watch it. So, anyway, that has nothing to do with what I'm talking about. I do that a lot. Ramble. So anyway, so you carve the individual shingles in, and then that's it. It's much faster to do it that way than any other way. So it really wouldn't take me a lot of time to redo the roof if I wanted to, and I still may. So now this to be painted is actually not that difficult because it's completely disassemblable. So we got the interior here, which would be a good camera, I guess this one here. So you can see the entire upper floor there. That's going to be full of crates and stuff in there, right? And then we have the bottom floor. This here is the main area here. This is the ticket area where the ticket master or whatever you want to call them. Where does this go? This goes right here. So the station master, he takes your ticket and gives you a ticket, whatever, and tells you when the trains are coming and all that shit and everything. That's this area here. I'm going to put it like a park bench type thing here for people to sit on. And it's going to have like a sign on the wall for the train schedule. And back here, behind this wall here, and this area here, this is his private office. And possibly maybe it'll have like a little bed and a roll-up desk, one of the desks with the roll-up top, some cupboards and stuff like that for him. He's got a little trap door to get down in the basement, which this here is also the coal bunker kind of thing. You can get downstairs. I added a fireplace. I know that these places normally wouldn't have fireplaces. They'd have a stove, either a coal-burning stove or a wood-burning stove. That would be much more common and much more sense. But I wanted a fireplace. I've never made a fireplace. This is my first attempt, right? And I really wanted to try making another one. So I said, fuck it. And I said, we're going to have a fireplace. So the fireplace is probably going to have maybe some shit on it. I don't really know what I'm going to put on it. Maybe a little ship model, if I can find one or make one. I have a little ship model sitting on the mantelpiece. Maybe that'd be cool. Yeah, so that's basically it for this thing. There's nothing else that I'm probably going to really do to this other than what I had already mentioned. But especially it'll be adding the little bits of furniture like the bench, so the cupboards, the roll-up desk, and the sign, and that's about it. Now there won't actually be a station master in here because it's occupied by Germans, so I might have some officers in there studying a map over the counter that's in there, and maybe another officer sitting on the bench, you know. It'll be very difficult to see them in there, but I am planning on leaving this so I can remove it, you know. So, you know, if I ever wanted to show anyone, I could lift the roof off and I can lift the whole building off and, you know, show everybody what's inside. For future whatever. What else? Oh, I think that's about it. Right, so the brickwork. Now, I've already shot this and demonstrated this on a previous take of this, but it didn't work out. So this is the results. Here, I'll show it on this. This is the results of the demonstration. That's brickwork. And that is the loose stone work that I demonstrated. Now, I did film on the big portal that's up there for the train tunnel. I carved out quite a bit of that, and I filmed the whole thing, and I'm actually showing a bit of it now. It's very long, and it takes a long time to get through it all, so I'm not going to torture you with that. I am going to demonstrate how I do it on this little piece of foam, though, but I'm going to have to zoom the camera in to do it because it's too far away to do it, so just give me a second. All right, so normally when I'm doing brickwork like what's on the front of the train station here, this even, somewhat straight brickwork, as opposed to this rough looking piled stone, like it's almost like a stone wall. Both of these are mortared type structures. It you can do the same thing with an unmortared, like a field stone wall, but it's better to actually use small stones and then use thin glue to glue them together rather than try to carve it in foam. It looks more realistic, I find, when you do that. So anyway, so the first thing you need to do is carve some horizontal lines to start you off for basically where the bricks are going to go. Now, different bricks have different sizes, of course. So basically, you decide what brick you're modeling. There, you can actually look it up. It's fairly easy to find, believe it or not. It's like the different bricks are used by different countries throughout Europe. And you can find the dimensions of the bricks and then scale them down to 35th scale or 42nd or 48th or whatever. It's easy to do. You just take the dimension. So say the brick is 7 3/4 inch long by 3 3/4 inch wide by whatever, how many high. You just take all those dimensions, divide them by 35, and that's the size of your brick, right? So, and then you can create a template on a piece of paper or a piece of card, like cardboard card, and then mark it out using a ruler. You know, this is, if I can just find a piece of paper here. So if you take a piece of paper and you just mark out the the marks for where your bricks are going to go. So like every, let's say it's you did your math and it comes out it's every 5 millimeters. So you mark it out like that, and then when you're doing your bricks, you lay it on and you just put it like a hash mark every 5 millimeters, right? And you do it like a bunch of dots there, and then you come over and then you do it again. That way you can get them going straight, right? So you have dot, 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 dot. And then you just line up those dots. Use a steel ruler. Don't use plastic rulers. Plastic rulers are junk. The only time they're useful is because you can see through them, right? That's the only time a plastic ruler is of any use. But steel rulers are best. And don't get the ones that have rounded edges here. The hash marks have to go right to the end. Right to the end. Right? And they have a nice corner right here. Right? Nice hard corner. No rounded edges. Right. So now that you've marked out, you know, every 5 centimeters you're going to have a horizontal line for your bricks, because that's what it told you. You take a sharp wide tool, like this. This is a sculpting tool. I bought these on Amazon. They're basically for sculpting clay. Came in a set and all these weird things. But it's these blades that I wanted, and this rounded tip that I wanted right here for doing brickwork. This is why I bought the whole set. I also wanted this for doing tiles and doing shingles. So this actually was bent this way, but I didn't like that, so I straightened it out. So it's actually more useful to me this way. I don't really have much use for this one here. I haven't found a use yet, but so these are the ones that I use. If you can see these, if you want to buy them, I don't actually know what they're called. They have a name, I'm pretty sure of it, but I just don't know what they are. So anyway, these are what I use. All right, it's got a nice thick blade, but I sharpened it. You got to sharpen it so it cuts through the foam nice. Foam will dull your knives pretty quickly, so you're gonna have to sharpen them pretty much every project. So once you got your things marked out, you score in your horizontal lines, which I've already done, right? You know, keep them fairly deep and straight, but go slow. Don't go fast, because if you go and keep your blade angled low, don't have your blade straight up and down. If you angle it like this, right, it will, actually I'll show you what happens if you don't. All right, so if you have your blade angled like this, it does that. If you angle it low, see, it glides through. All right, this is very important to do that. The other thing that's very important to do before you even start, sand your surface with a rough sander, because if you don't, see how this is shiny, right? That's because this was cut at the factory with a hot wire, basically big industrial sized one, and it sealed all of the pores. And when it did it, you need to open those in order to make it a carvable surface. So if you sand it, it opens them all back up again. Like even here where I cut it, it's still, that's all sealed, right? Same thing on the back here. So when you sand it, it opens it up and it makes it very, very carvable. Now I've already sanded this. You can see the difference, right? Now it's not shiny anymore. So you always sand it first. And then once you get your horizontal lines carved in, right, remember, keep your blade angled low, not high, nice and low, you got to put your bricks in. So again, you do your hash marks again, so you know your bricks are, I don't actually know, it depends. I used to have different pieces of card lying around here with different scale bricks already hashed into them. But when I built my cave, I lost them. I have no idea where they are. I probably should have made up new ones when I did the train station, but I forgot all about it. So, all right, so 1 centimeter, which is way too big for 35th scale. We're going to start over here and make some dots. 1 centimeter. You got to watch using Sharpie markers on projects, because acrylic paint likes to suck up the ink from a Sharpie marker. It doesn't cover it. It absorbs it. So if you draw on something with a Sharpie marker, it'll bleed through over time. Sometimes it takes weeks, sometimes it takes years, and all of a sudden you'll see that your notes that you wrote, this will bleed through. I have to seal this with like Mod Podge before I can prime it, otherwise it'll bleed through. Right, so for this, if I can find it, there it is. This is when I use a clear ruler, because I can see where the bricks go. All right, so because this thing is wedge-shaped, all right, it's a nice wedge-shaped blade, I have to do two cuts, all right? So, first cut, second cut, and you make them nice and deep. And you do that because you're going to, after you've done your rock work, and you're going to paint it and everything, you're going to fill all these seams with either plaster or drywall compound, like wall filler compound, like Durotex or whatever it's called, whatever it is that you happen to have lying around. And so after you've painted your bricks, you go back over with that plaster or wall compound and you fill all these seams with a thin version of the plaster. That's what I do anyway. And it becomes the mortar. And when it dries, it's quite tough, and you can stain it, you can paint it, you can weather it. It's pretty cool, actually. Now this isn't perfect because I can barely see what I'm doing, so it's not going to be amazing looking work, but that's not really the point. It's the method, not the result, that we're going after. So that's the rough idea what it looks like. So now I want to make sure that all these lines are scored nice and deep. I should have already done this when I put them in the first time. I'm just making sure because I don't remember if I did when I originally cut them. They seem to be. It's okay if you damage some along the way. Unless you're doing like a pristine office building or something like that, a little bit of damage to the brickwork just adds a little bit of character. But if you're doing like a pristine office project or something like that, you don't want to do that. You want them to be as perfect as possible then. All right, so now I'm going to take the rounded end of the this tool. I have no idea what this tool is called, but I use the rounded end. And I just dent the bricks a bit. Try not to make them uniform, so push some in a little bit further than the others, but not too hard. Again, you don't want it to, it depends on what you're going after. If you're going for like an office block or something like that, then you want nice and neat. If you're going for something a bit more rustic or old or ruins or, you know, antique-like, then go a little bit harder. All right, so that's that. Now, if I want to go a little bit more crazy, turn the tool over, and I can beat up a couple of bricks, push them in a bit, give them a bit more character. And I can even rip one out. Give it a interesting look. There, a little bit of character. All right. So that's like a mortared brick wall type thing. Now this is a mortared like a natural stone. Like they picked up the stones, piled them together, and then added mortar to make them stick together. That one's not as common, but like around urban areas and stuff like that. But you'll see them. Well, I've seen them anyway, out in like industrial areas for around train tunnels and stuff like that and everything, which is why I used it for the train tunnel. But I also used it for the foundation of the train station. The train station itself, the main part of the foundation, is like regular brick, but the platform is like mortared stone. So that's what we're going to do here. This is actually pretty simple, all right, to make this look. Now, one thing you got to keep in mind, the stones, for their size, can't be too big. You have to keep them in mind for the scale that you're working on. So keep a picture of the figures or an appropriate sized figure for the scale that you're working on, and make the stones no bigger than the size of a man's chest, because these stones were piled by a person, and generally they're not superhuman, so they can't pick up a stone that's like this big. A stone this big would weigh like 220 pounds, and most people can't pick that up and move it around. Stone is very difficult to move. I have done a lot of landscaping, and so I've done a lot of rock walls and stuff like that, and I know how difficult it is to move stone when you're by yourself. And so stones that are any bigger than the size of your chest, that's about as big as you're going to get. So 35, maybe 55 pounds tops, anything more than that, and you're not going to get a whole lot of work done because you're exhausted and you've hurt yourself. Your shoulders are fucked, and you've hurt your hands and, you know, worn out your gloves, your back is murdered. So yeah, you got to keep in mind the scale that you're working in. If you notice some of your rocks are too big, that's okay, you can cut them in half. All right, so it's a pretty simple process. You don't want to make them too puzzle piece. So they don't fit together perfectly. Rocks don't come that way. That's what the mortar's for. The mortar fills in the gaps that the rocks can't fill. And don't make them all the same size. That's my watch telling me to get the fuck off my ass. Apparently I've been here for longer than 20 minutes. Alright, so you get the idea there. So that's where, how it looks when you start. Alright, now I've already sanded this surface, so you got to do that like you did the other side too. Now the next thing you want to do is take a rounded tool. It doesn't have to be this tool exactly, it can be any kind of rounded tool. It could be like a blunted pencil or a crayon or something like that. Actually, I wouldn't suggest using a crayon, but you know, a rounded piece of like a dulled nail or something like that. As long as it's smooth and rounded, right? And you can vary its texture by like flipping it over, and you got like that. That way it saves you time grabbing different tools and stuff like that. So anyway, so now you want to add a little bit of texture to the rocks. Try to keep it different, random. Take a couple, like push them in a bit, right? That way it gives it a little bit of a three-dimensional sort of feel. And after that's done, I'll go back and do some real random shapes and stuff. And that's essentially it. That's basically what you do. These are easier. They can be a little bit more mentally exhausting because you actually have to think about the rocks as you're going more than you do with bricks. Bricks are more methodical. You just get mechanical with them, like doing tracks, and away you go. But these, you actually have to pay attention to what you're doing, otherwise you'll lose your focus and you end up with rocks that are too big, rocks that are too uniform, rocks that are wonky looking, they're too puzzle-like, they fit together too well. So those are the things that you got to avoid. So I guess that's about it. There's nothing else that I wanted to... Yeah, that was about it. So I think the next video that I'm going to have is probably going to be another few weeks. It'll probably be the water tower. I'll come back and talk about the water tower. And then I'm going to start possibly texturing the surface of the diorama itself. Getting that ready. One thing that I only have two vehicles left to go on the diorama, and that's the a second Fahrgestell. That's the ammunition hauler. It carries the ammunition around for the Carls. I have one built on the diorama, and I want to add a second one that's actually dismounting from one of the flat cars. Right now I have a Panzer III placeholding for it. There's not going to be any tanks at all on the scene, actually. Well, unless you count the Fahrgestells and the Carl. But, so I still need to build that second Fahrgestell, and I'm holding off on that because I know it's going to be a bit of a ball kick to build that. The other thing is I have a diesel locomotive that I want to add to the scene. That delivered the Fahrgestells, and the trouble with that, unfortunately, is there's only one kit on the market of the diesel locomotives that the Germans used, well, of that type anyway, that was used to haul around the mortars and the large guns. Unfortunately, no one's made a kit of the actual train that did that. Trumpeter made one of the C-12, which never left the borders of Germany and was only used around like marshalling yards and stuff, and Germany only made 12 of them, or 10 of them, 10 of them. And that's the kit that Trumpeter decided to build. Not the C-14, which was very, very common, was used to haul around the Dora, the Leopold, the mortar Carls, and was quite the busy beaver, right? No, they didn't do that. They did the C-12, which hardly anyone ever saw. Thankfully, there's not a great big a difference between the C-12 and the C-14. The C-14 is slightly bigger, but not enough that you would notice it unless the two of them are sitting next to each other. So if there's only one on the diorama, I'll probably get away with it. The big things between them is the placement of the wheels. Right, the wheels are slightly further apart on the C-14, and the C-14 has the sand. It's a traction system that sits on the front. It squirts sand on the rails under the wheels and gives the wheels traction. It's the same thing that's on the BR-52. All those hoses that, if you remember, all the hoses that I had trouble, the vinyl ones. That's what those are. It's a sand delivery system. I thought it was a hydraulic line, but it's not. It's for delivering traction sand. It squirts it onto the wheels, and you know it gives it traction. Learn something cool every day. These trains are fucking amazing things. All these little itty bitty bits of information that I stumbled across just doing a little bit of research just feeds my. It's like candy for my brain. It's too bad I'll never remember it all. So anyway, the other problem with the Trumpeter kit is it's very poorly detailed. The interior of the cabin is very sloppy detailed and it's very poor detail. The wheel assembly for the C-12 that they make is very poorly detailed. And nobody offers a C14 kit that's you can buy right now. There were some resin kits, but I can't find them. And I'm willing to bet that if I did, they'd cost me a fortune, and I'm not interested in paying that. So I'm stuck with trying to fudge through with a C12 and making it look like a C14, which is what I'm going to do. That's on its way. It should be here sometime in May, because that's what it said when I bought it. So between March and May was the delivery window. Yeah, apparently they've moved China another 20,000 kilometers further away from me, and it takes now another 6 months to get it here. What else? Anything else? No, I think that was it. Just the C12. That's the other speed bump that I gotta traverse. So I think that's it. Right, so the next couple of videos, it'll probably be circling around the water tower, and maybe, I gotta scratch build a Das Scheißenhaus, a shithouse, an outhouse. So I might do another video on that. I've built a shithouse before, but it's been a while, so I'm gonna do another one. I don't know where I'm gonna put it on there, but I'm gonna do it anyway, just so I have it, and if I find a place to put it, I'll put it on there. So. There's Murphy. Murphy's just showed up. He's right behind me. Where is he? Where is he, Murph? There he is. Hi, Murphy. How you doing, buddy? You a good boy? Yeah? Murphy got a haircut today. Yeah, I know. I had him on the bench for like a good 90 minutes cutting his hair. And he was a good dog. Sat there the whole time. Didn't move. It was awesome. Anyway, that's all I got. You guys be good. Keep your stick on the ice. Bye for now. Mm-hmm. 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 Mm-hmm.